All right, it is Tuesday evening, and I thought, at least for now, maybe it's not going to go through the whole season, but at least for now, I'm going to try to make a Seahawks video every Tuesday night to talk about more the state of the football team rather than any one specific game. So this video will not be talking about the Bengals game we just played. It's not going to be about the Steelers game that we're going to play on Sunday. It's not going to be about the Eagles game we're going to play or the Panthers game, or it's not about any one game. It's where is the team? Where are they headed? How can they get better? How can they be more like the team that I want them to be? How can they basically get themselves in a position where they can compete for a title? Because, look, I'm going to keep saying it. Every single year where your team has a franchise quarterback, and we do right now, you have to be gunning to compete for a Super Bowl. If you're not, what's the point of having that franchise quarterback? So we're paying a quarterback $40 million this year to play for us. So I'm not about to punt on a season, no matter how questionable things look. So I was thinking about what this video could be about. I was thinking about maybe making it about how irritated I am at the decision making that goes on with this organization in terms of, play calling and overall general philosophy, because it just wears on me, especially after a game like we played on Sunday where we did win. And excuse me, let me be clear. The only thing I care about right now is tallying wins and losses. How you look in September has no bearing on how you look in December and January. The only thing that matters for the first 3 months of the season is tallying wins and losses. I don't care if every game is a 1-point win and we look terrible in all the games. If we win all the games, then I'm fine because the team that you field in December and January has very little resemblance to the team you field in those first 3 months. If you want to start worrying about how your team looks or whether or not you're winning the right way, I'll save that for December, but it does wear on you because I just feel like that, Pete Carroll especially, combined with Brian Schottenheimer, I mean, Brian Schottenheimer is an extension of Pete Carroll. I just feel like they think about football the wrong way in many ways. And I thought about making this video about some of the things that Pete Carroll said after the Bengals game because I listened to some of his post-game comments. I listened to the way he addressed certain points, and it made me mad. A lot of what he said just makes no sense to me, and a lot of it tells me that he's not going to change, and it tells me that this team is not going to be as good as it can be as long as that's the case. And that frustrates me. It frustrates me because we might have the best deep ball quarterback in the league and we don't use it enough. We might have two of the best deep threat wide receivers in football. We'll see about DK, but we know about Tyler, and we're not going to use that enough. We have this team. I mean, I don't want to say we can do everything that the Kansas City Chiefs are doing, but we can do a lot of the things that the Kansas City Chiefs are doing. We have a similar type of quarterback. We have a similar, not as good, but a similar skill set at wide receiver. And I just know it's not going to happen. And it frustrates me because I see these other teams, they're starting to get it. Dallas is starting to get it. The Cardinals, they might be starting to get it. I don't know. We need to see a few more games. The Bengals might be starting to get it. I love their game plan on offense on Sunday. And I just know my team's not ever going to get it. But I don't really want to talk about that right now. Maybe that'll be in a future video because it's not going to change. Pete Carroll doesn't listen to me. Pete Carroll is not going to suddenly go, "Hey, the way I've been thinking about football for 40 years is wrong. I should do the opposite of what I'm doing on offense right now." Brian Schottenheimer, who is, an extension of Pete Carroll, is not going to suddenly change his offensive game plan that has gotten him a job in Seattle and produced theoretically good results last year. So it's not going to change. So until it starts costing us games, maybe I'll just keep quiet about that. So I'm not going to talk about that. I was going to talk about maybe some of the, injuries that piled up after the Sunday game. There are quite a few that have me very concerned for the near future, and they're really not what we need when we're already dealing with some of the issues that we are. But I can't do anything about that either. Nobody can. I mean, nobody's got a magic wand they can wave to make Puna Ford's leg heal up, or Nico Thorpe's leg heal up, or get Ugo Amadi at 100%, or it is what it is. So I didn't want to address that either. I want to talk about something that we could actually potentially do something about. So I am bringing out the whiteboard. It's been a while. What's up, old friend? And I am thinking about what can this team do to address the problem at safety? Because for the kind of team that we want to be, for the team that, that Pete Carroll and Brian Schottenheimer and Ken Norton want to put out there, we are, in terms of players and skills, we are looking, in my opinion, sharp. The defensive line is going to be very deep by the midpoint of the season, unless somebody, rips their knee in half. When we get Reed back, when we get Anza back, when we get now Puna back, when we get Clowney up at 100%, we're going to be very deep. We're going to be very good. Linebacker, we probably have the best linebackers in the league. I like what we're doing at receiver. The offensive line, I mean, the depth, you can question it a little bit, but our guys are our guys. Either they're going to play better in the future or they're not. Running back is solid. I mean, all these positions, I feel like we're set and we're going to be as good as we're going to be. But I'm thinking about that one safety spot because, the secondary, it's having some problems right now. And some of it we can't do very much about. I mean, we just need Trey Flowers to play better, quite simply. We need Nico Thorpe to get healthy. We need Jamar Taylor, who we just signed, who, he's a fringe NFL player, to play well when he gets on the field, if he indeed does. We need Ugo Amadi to get well soon. The answers at cornerback are, we pick up some of the guys we had in the preseason or the guys that we have just play well. But I'm thinking about this safety thing. I was thinking about it today. The Tedrick Thompson thing, look, not only do we as fans care when Tedrick Thompson does something like that, Pete Carroll really cares. A lot of things that happened to that game on Sunday that were bad, Pete Carroll can live with. He doesn't care about the three and outs as much as we want him to. I don't think he cares about the short passing game that the Bengals used as much as we would like him to. I think he's willing to live with that stuff. I think he's willing to live with the offensive line, although he obviously wants them to get better. He's willing to live with maybe some of the aggression penalties. I think he's willing to live with a lot of stuff that I, as a head coach, would not be willing to live with, but he will not live with giving up a big play over the top because your safety messed up. That I could tell by the way he was talking. I can tell by, just what I know about him as a head coach. He's not going to be okay with that. And Tedrick Thompson, who inexcusably got beat over the top by John Ross, just basically was setting up to field a punt on what should have been an interception or a knockdown, or even a tackle after a catch, just completely botched the play, gave up a end of half touchdown. And if he doesn't give up that touchdown, we might be feeling very differently right now about this team. Maybe we win by 2 scores and we're like, okay, we played okay. Defense looks good. We might not be having these concerns right now with this roster. So this is not the first time Tedrick's done something like that. Tedrick had a very similar play against the Detroit Lions last year. Tedrick does not make any plays. He does not have, I think he has one interception, and it came on a Hail Mary play at the end of the first half against the Rams last year. He is not a big hitter. He is not an amazing tackler. He's not a great box safety. The only thing we ask of Tedrick Thompson is to be a ball hawk down the field, to cover the deep zones and not allow big plays. And he's in year three, and he's not doing it, and it's not getting better. And if there's one thing that I think Pete Carroll might overreact to, or not overreact, but have an extreme reaction to, it's Tristan, it's excuse me, Tedrick Thompson giving up a play like that. That, I think, warrants a look at how we could replace him because, I mean, I can tell you this. For whatever reason, it seems like the organization currently does not really like Marquise Blair. I like him a lot. I liked what I saw in preseason. Sorry. But it seems like we don't trust him to, be consistent, trust him to make the right plays right now. We maybe don't trust him to totally know the defense. I mean, he is a rookie. It's not the most surprising thing in the world. Ugo Amadi, it looks like we trust him more at cornerback than safety, so it's not him. The organization might be willing to give Delano Hill a chance next, but I don't see anything from Delano Hill either. He does nothing for me. I don't think he's going to be any better or worse than Tedrick. And then it gets like who you looking at? So here are some guys that I want Seattle to kick the tires on sooner rather than later. Remember, it's week two now. You can sign players and have no guarantees in their contracts. You can give people a 1-year deal with no guarantees. That's part of the reason why some players wait till after week one to sign. So three guys, you probably already familiarized yourself with their names because I've been holding them here for like the last billion minutes. And I mean, you probably know them from their time in the NFL, but I want Seattle to kick the tires on at least one of these three guys. The number one name, the most interesting name, Eric Berry, formerly of the Kansas City Chiefs, played safety for them for, what, 7 or 8 years? Was really good. He made five Pro Bowls. He made the All-Pro team 3 times, one of the best safeties in the league, right up there with Earl. They gave him a monster extension. And then he tore his Achilles 2 years ago. He had other health issues last year. He's played in like 4 games over the past 2 seasons and they cut him. He's still out there. So, Eric Berry, he's like 31 or 32 now, I think. So I don't want to pretend like you're going to get an all pro if you sign him. Obviously, that's not the case. But the potential for Eric Berry is you don't usually see that kind of potential from a dude who is still a free agent in week two of the NFL season. Usually he's long gone, but this dude made the Pro Bowl and the All-Pro first team 3 years ago. That's not that long ago. That's a couple of injuries ago. He's not going to be that good again, but he could be better than you expect from a guy you pick up mid-season. So Eric Berry, the potential is there. The negatives, the downside would of course just be the injuries. The Achilles is one thing, but last year he had a bone spur that was digging into his Achilles, which, to me just sounds nasty. So last year he played in 2 games and then he played in the AFC title game, and that was it. I mean, he might be physically unable to handle the rigors of the position, and every play he plays might he might be a ticking time bomb. The best I can say, we might not need him for long. Eric Berry could just be a stopgap until Blair gets up to speed. I don't know where he is in his development. I don't know where the coaches think he is, but I don't hear his name. I don't hear Blair's name when they talk about replacing Tedrick. I hear Delano Hill. So that tells me Blair's at least right now not ready. So we would need Eric Berry until we feel that Blair's ready. I don't know when that is, but maybe it wouldn't be for long. Next name, these are significantly less fun to think about. They might be more practical. George Iloka. He played for the Bengals for many years. He was never an all-pro or anything like that, but he was a pretty solid player for quite a few years. Came into the league in 2012, had quite a few decent seasons with the Bengals. And then 2 years ago, he got cut, and then he spent a year on the Vikings and did very little. And then at the beginning of this season, the Cowboys signed him and like a month later let him go. So right then and there, you kind of see the good and the bad. He's in his physical prime still. He's 29. And the other thing I really like about him is that he's big. He's like 6'4", 225, not that far away from what Cam Chancellor was. He's a bigger safety. So we could move Bradley McDougal to, free safety and let Ioka maybe patrol the, underneath lanes like Cam did. Maybe he could handle at least part of that role. So that's what I like about Ioka. What I don't like, I mean, the Cowboys, who have a good defense, but they don't have all pros at safety. They didn't sign Earl Thomas as much as they wanted to. And they picked him up, and a month later they were like, beat it. Phooey on you. We'll roll with, what we have, which is, I think Jeff Heath might still be starting for the Cowboys. I'm not sure, but the fact that they would bring him in, sign him, and then cut him after a month, having played in no games and done nothing but training camp, it makes you think that maybe there's something like really wrong with him. Like maybe the way he played in the NFL has already beaten up his body and he's got nothing left. But I want to kick the tires. And the last name I'm going to throw out here is TJ McDonald. Played for the Rams for a little bit. He played for the Dolphins for a couple years. And honestly, last time he played in the NFL, he was pretty good. He had a career high 3 interceptions his last year in Miami, and they signed him to a big contract right before that. And then after 1 year on that big contract, he got cut, but it seemed like it was more about Miami just wanting to shed salary and move on and, sorry to say, tank this year than it did his performance. He had a pretty good season by all metrics that I can find. So last time he played, which was last season, seemed like he was all right. And he's only 28. He is in his prime, absolutely. There's no reason to believe he's washed up already. He hasn't been in the league that long. So TJ McDonald, very interesting. I don't know why anyone's not picked him up. It seems like he just kind of got lost in the wash of a very safety heavy free agent class with Landon Collins and Earl Thomas and some of the other guys that got big contracts. TJ McDonald just kind of got left behind because he's just decent. The downside I see is the off-field issues that TJ has had. He's got a DUI a couple years ago. He had a drug possession charge, and he's been suspended for performance-enhancing drugs. That was actually just 2 years ago. So he missed 8 games already. So if he gets caught again, I think he's done for a year, which is not going to do us any good. And maybe there's a little red flag stuff going on there, but in terms of what we saw from him last year, as recently as last year, pretty dang good. So that's me trying to be constructive. I want to talk about things that can be fixed, and the Seahawks safety position can be fixed. And I think that we are best served to go get a veteran to hold things over while somebody on the roster, some young guy, tries to figure it out. Blair, Tedrick, Delano Hill, I don't know, but I don't think any of them are ready right now. And that's going to be a problem because if we start giving up big plays over the top like we did against the Bengals, then the defense doesn't have much for you because we're giving up the short stuff already. You add in the long stuff, it could be a long season. And 1 weak link is enough, as we clearly saw on Sunday. All right. That's my video for this week. I'll try to make a new Thursday video every week going forward. Just break down something about the team that I like or I don't like or what I think we can do. So for this week, I'll just leave it at Pete Carroll, go bring me Eric Berry. I'll take TJ McDonald. Georgioka would be okay. And make us better. All right, peace.